Hello, I would love to let you in on a little secret. The great God of the universe has been eagerly anticipating this very moment to spend with you. And I'm so glad that you have joined us for worship. And I invite you at this time to share on Facebook, if you're worshiping on Facebook. And I also invite you to text in your attendance and let us know that you're worshiping with us by texting your names to the phone number that you see below. And if you have never done that before, please text just the simple word connect to that phone number so that we can begin to get to know you and get to know that you are worshiping with us. We are so glad that you are here, and we are excited about a wonderful time of worship together. Would you pray with me? Lord, we have come to worship you. We give you thanks and we give you praise for who you are. And we pray that over these next several minutes of singing worship songs and praying and learning and growing and meditating on your word, God, that you would encounter us in a whole new way. And we pray that in Jesus' name, amen. And at this time, my friend Ken has some growth opportunities for discipleship that he'd like to share with you.
Hi, I'm Ken Revenaugh. I'd like to tell you about a couple of Christmas and discipleship growth opportunities at SunRise. First, bring your family or come by yourself. Take a deep breath. Reflect on the true meaning of Christmas during our candlelight, communion, and prayer service inside the church building on December 20th. Come anytime between 12:30 and 2, and you'll be safely ushered into the worship space and then greeted by one of our pastors for the time of Holy Communion. We have some amazing online and in-building Christmas Eve opportunities as well for you and your family to be able to celebrate the birth of our Savior. One of these options is to reserve a private room for your family and close friends, up to 15 people. These private rooms are decorated in a perfect way for you and your loved ones to worship together safely in the church building. All in-building Christmas Eve worship services may also be viewed in a video format with the pastors at every service. There will be an opportunity for communion and the family pictures in front of the Christmas tree. A discipleship growth opportunity could be found in our Financial Peace course. It's a life-changing course that coaches you how to crush debt, invest in your future, and manage your resources like never before. What a great time to work on our finances when many of us are having to watch our money like never before. These in-person classes will begin January 13th and finish on March 10th. To get more information, please visit our website. And would you join us now in worship?
Stars in the sky look down with
I invite you, wherever you are, to join your hearts in prayer with me. Emmanuel, the amazing and the powerful and the beautiful truth that God is with us. We need that truth today, God. We thank you for coming to this earth and putting on flesh as a little baby, and bringing to us the reality that you are with us. Whatever we're facing, whatever we're experiencing, whatever our situation is, at work or at school or our financial situation or our health situation, God, no matter what, Emmanuel, you are with us. We celebrate Advent in a time of waiting for you. But the reality is that you already came to your people, and your presence and your Holy Spirit are available to us even now. God, open our eyes that we may see you. Open our hearts that we may long for you and pray and ask for you to come and to be with us in our lives even today. Lord, we pray the prayer together that you taught us to pray, and lift our voices and say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. This power and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. If you've enjoyed the presence of God wherever you're worshiping or here today, would you just say amen?
Amen.
I'm so glad that we are setting apart some time to be together and to spend time worshiping God. Our church and its ministries continue to roll along like they do every day, every week. And this past week, one of our service coordinators had an opportunity for our Neighbor Helping Neighbor ministry, had an opportunity to spend several hours with a family. One of the family members was 8 months pregnant, and there was also a toddler, and they were able to continue in their hotel because of your generosity, and they are moving into a place of their own this week. And so they had several nights this week that they weren't on the street as they were trying to work their way out of being unsheltered. And I thank you for your generosity and how you continue to support SunRise with your giving. Its missions and ministries are just such a blessing. Another person told me a story that when they made a food delivery this week, that they stood socially distanced, but that the person just wanted to talk, and they had this heart-to-heart conversation, and the person was just telling them what a blessing it was just to have them be there to talk to and to pray with after the food delivery. So anyway, I just am so blessed by everything that everybody's doing and giving, and I wanted to share with you several ways that you can choose to give right now. One is that you can send a check through the physical mail, if that's the thing you're most comfortable with. Also, you can text your giving to the number that you see on the screen, 636-764-4049. You just text the amount. And you can also give online with our new way to give there, and it's sunrisefamily.org/offering. And then it's exciting that we also have resumed our in-building worship opportunities, both on Thursday nights and on Sunday mornings. And so if you are in one of those, then I invite you to share your generosity in the boxes at the back before you leave the sanctuary today. And at this time, we're going to be celebrating, this is week 3 of Advent, and then hearing our teaching for the day.
Yes, friends, it is that third weekend in the season of Advent, and we have lit today the candle of peace. And we saw in that just the opportunity for God's peace to just wash all over us. And this is also our third week of our Advent series, Christmas series, called Keeping It Real, about overcoming the stress of the season, not only of the season of Christmas and Advent, but the extended season of 2020. Now, today we're going to be talking about overcoming the stress of extremism. So that candle of peace, that's pretty important to hold on to over the next few moments that we're talking. Now, I always love when I bring in a big word like that. I love to know what the definition is that I'm working with. So I'm going to share this working definition for us. So extremism is the promotion of radical measures or views that go beyond an acceptable, normal, or reasonable limit. Now, the word that can also be used with that is excessive, and probably we'll hear excessive extremism several times during this teaching. Now, Most often, when you hear the word extremism, it usually is referring to a political or religious sense, to refer to an ideology of some type that is considered to be way far outside the mainstream attitudes of society. But 2020 has proven that there is all kinds of extremism, and it's not just in religious or political areas. It is in virtually everything. People have strong opinions. People love to debate, and many times they are unhealthy and unhelpful senses of extremism. So the working definition for tonight is this unhealthy, excessive, unhelpful type of extremism that just pushes us to the very edge. So now, if last week Mary was our rock star example for overcoming the unknown, then this week Herod is the poster boy for extremism. Now, we're introduced to Herod in Matthew, the second chapter. So if you have your Bibles, we're going to look at one verse there and a handful of verses throughout the rest of the Bible today. But we're going to start in Matthew 2, where we are introduced for the very first time to Herod. And we're going to be reading from verse number 16. And it begins by saying this: when Herod realized that he had been outwitted by the Magi, he was furious. So we need to stop right there. We need to kind of set this up, because the Magi, or the wise men, are introduced to us at the beginning of Matthew, the second chapter. They are the ones who have been following the star that they saw and are following because their wisdom tells them that they're looking for the newborn king of the Jews. Now, they arrive in Jerusalem and immediately have an opportunity to have an audience with King Herod. And they inquire, where is this new king so that we may go and worship? Well, Herod was curious not to worship. He was curious because he saw and heard about a new king that could potentially be a threat to his throne. So he asked the wise men, when you locate this baby, please return and let me know so I can go and worship. Matthew 2 continues that the wise men again saw the star that arrived in the east. And I guess if you've been following anything, you know that on December 21st, we have an opportunity to almost experience a once in an 800-year opportunity where three of the planets come together and they see this kind of as a star maybe that the wise men saw as well. I wasn't around 800 years ago. Maybe you were. If you were, you might put that over in the comments section if you remember the last time that star was around. But the wise men found Jesus. They went into the house that he was located, and they worshiped him and left him with gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Now, as they were preparing to return, they said a divine dream came to them, and they were warned to return to their homes by a route other than going back through Jerusalem, and so they would have to avoid that contact with Herod. So that's kind of where we're set up. So you can see why, kind of the irony that King Herod was furious that the wise men deceived him. Verse 16 goes on to say, and he, being Herod, gave orders to kill all the boys in Bethlehem and its vicinity who were 2 years old and under, in accordance with the time he had learned from the Magi. So let's take a moment and talk about this guy named Herod. King Herod, who is he? And why does he play such a prominent role as an excessive extremist? Well, King Herod ruled in Judea as a puppet king under the watchful eye of the Roman Empire, beginning in 37 BC and ended in 4 BC. Now, wait a minute. You say, wait a minute, Pastor Jim. You just said that he was there when Jesus was born. Why? Don't worry about it. That's a whole different sermon about how they misfigured when Jesus was born and the king. And so anyway, 4 BC is when he died, after the birth of Jesus. Now, he was raised as a Jew, but he also lived in the city of Rome, and he came BFFs with Mark Anthony. And so it was Mark Anthony that helped him rally some Roman troops to go back to Jerusalem and kick out the sitting king who was opposed to Roman rule and was trying to run him out. And so he gathered the throne in 37 BC. Now, I learned years ago in a writing class about novels that you cannot have a character that is extremely bad or extremely good, because no one will believe that. You got to have a little bit of mix. And so Herod actually had some points that is lifted up in history as being pretty good. Some of his major accomplishments. Well, he restored the temple in Jerusalem to the greatest splendor that it has ever existed in its history. He also effectively built the city of Caesarea and its port to make it a prominent place for shipping to come in and out of the Holy Land. He also went throughout the entire area of Israel and built cities and fortresses to make the nation much more secure against invading armies. He also did a great job of keeping peace between Rome and the Jewish revolutionists. So he had that going for him. But at the same time, Herod was a severely deranged individual. We know from history that he murdered three of his sons, one of his 10 wives, which speaks to his derangement right there, his wife's mother-in-law, simply because he feared that they might be planning to overthrow him and take his crown. On his dying deathbed, he ordered the execution of 100 prominent Jewish leaders because he was concerned that they would not mourn his death when it happened. So here we have a paranoid man who would, by any definition, fit an extremist, an excessive extremist. So he directed the murder of all male children in the city of Bethlehem under the age of 2 would seem to fit well with his delusional character. This is a tough passage of Scripture. This is a passage of Scripture that we often don't even address. For me, and maybe for you, there's a visceral reaction to the thought of killing innocent babies. Killing of innocent babies. And the opportunity for that standard question that we always have, if there is a God, why? It's probably not an answer any of us will be able to find out until we reach our eternal home. Some critics, because of that, have labeled this story as false, as a fable, as a myth, as an unreal story. Matthew is the only place I discovered, both in the Bible and in non-biblical areas, that record this statement of death that Herod sends out. And you would think a gruesome act like this would end up in some kind of record. It would make the news headlines, even back in the early first century. But since the noted Jewish historian Josephus does not mention it anywhere, many biblical critics use that as their ammunition to say that this didn't happen. This is known, by the way, as an argument from silence. And that is the weakest form of argument that you can have, is an argument from science. In fact, friends, a great rule of thumb for biblical understanding, interpretation, dissection, and even for life, is that the absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. Write this down. I'm going to say it again because it will serve you well in your life in discussions with anyone, especially extremists. The absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. Just because there's not a record of it doesn't mean that it didn't happen. In fact, many biblical scholars who believe this is a true statement from Matthew, they say the lack of public record is probably because of the numerical insignificance of Herod's actions. You see, I discovered this week that the reality is in first century Bethlehem, the total number of babies that would fall into the category of being under 2 and male probably were somewhere between 6 and 12 and maybe 15 at the most. So not enough really to get the interest of the historians to write down, especially when they were surrounded by Herod's almost daily atrocities of much greater proportion. And the reality is that the infant mortality rate in first century Palestine was at 30%. So really, 6 or 12 or 15 additional deaths of babies would go unnoticed. But it's horrific no matter the number. No matter the number of babies. You see, the Romans and King Herod They use brutality and sometimes deadly force to protect their state, to protect the Jewish religion, to protect the status quo, and even to protect their weakened reputation. And there's three great examples in the Bible. The first one, Jesus' death on the cross was not for any kind of crime committed, but simply because he posed a threat to the power of the status quo. John the Baptist was imprisoned and eventually beheaded because he irritated the son of King Herod, King Agrippa, and was an annoyance by challenging the king's morality. And then there's Matthew's record. The order by Herod to kill a handful of baby boys in Bethlehem for a reason that was selfish and self-serving. Friends, listen to this. This is important. Extremism is extremism no matter the body count. Extremism is ugly and vile and selfish and self-serving and inhuman. Extremism cannot be part of the kingdom of heaven or the actions of the people who follow Jesus. Can I get an amen on that?
Amen.
So we have a biblical record. But how do we overcome the stress created by the extremism of today? Friends, it is everywhere, and it is in everything. It's more than just religion and politics. It's in virtually every aspect of life. I discovered this great new item this week. Just released, Wallet Hub study ranked St. Louis, Missouri, as the third most, are you ready for this? The third most sinful city in the United States, only behind Las Vegas and Los Angeles. Now, I know, it shocked me. Now, to compare the rankings, Wallet Hub, who did the survey, compared 182 cities across the United States on several different dimensions, but really they boiled down to loosely fit into seven categories that reflect the seven deadly sins in the Bible. I don't know if they were aware of that or not, but they do. So how did St. Louis end up number three? Well, they ranked first overall in anger and hatred. Now, that includes, because I wanted to make sure I got this right, that included things like violent crimes, sex offenses, aggravated assaults, bullying, hate crime incidents, hate groups, deaths to firearms per capita, number of mass shootings, presence of terrorists, and all of that. So we ranked first in St. Louis. That's pretty extreme. We also ranked first, by the way, in the area of excesses and vices. And what that is, probably doesn't surprise us, fast food restaurants and excessive drinking, DUI-related fatalities, the share of smoking of adults, and I guess I helped us get there on this one, the drinking of coffee, the sharing of the population that uses marijuana and opioids and drug overdoses, and debt-to-income ratio put us number one in St. Louis. We were number 12 in jealousy, number 36 in lust, number 40 in vanity, number 60 in laziness, and number 61 in greed. And all of that added together put us third. That is a bronze medal that we should not be very proud of. But the reality is the temptation and the stress of extremism is everywhere. Overcoming stress and overcoming extremism created by that is vital for our health and for our well-being and for our safety and survival, friends. So any serious attempt on my part to overcome extremisms needs to be deeply grounded in God's Word. It needs to be deeply grounded in living out and living into God's peace that He offers us for our lives. Philippians 4. I want to go there. Paul's writing this letter to the church in Philippi from a Roman jail. Now imagine being in jail, waiting to go before Caesar, almost a certain death sentence, and Paul writes these words in the fourth chapter, beginning with verse 6 in Philippians. What a great prescription for all of us. Don't worry about anything, Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank God for all He has done. Verse 7. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. God's peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. So the first step in overcoming the stress of extremism is immersing ourselves deeply and daily in God's Word. Second, maybe a little bit harder, I need to make sure that I am not part of or contribute to any type of excessive extremism. I need to establish and not cross that fine line that exists between passion, conviction, and excessive extremism. What happens, friends, when we cross that line? Our history pages are littered with story after story of cults and crusades and tyrants and terrorists who have tried to force their ideology upon a group of people in the name of a divine purpose. Most of them flurry and then they fail. But sadly, they leave a path of destruction and brokenness and death behind. See, as followers of Jesus, we need to understand that resorting to violence as a way of forcing people into religious or political or social compliance is a violation of everything God stands for. There is no wiggle room. There is no negotiating. There is no searching scripture to find a way to validate it. It is just plain wrong. And in even a simpler way, as a follower of Jesus, we must look in the mirror. We must be willing to recognize any tendencies in our heart to use manipulation and coercion for the cause of Christ or our personal agendas. Friends, extremism never works. It always damages people. It corrupts the message of Jesus. Matthew 11, 12. I want to go there for a moment. In Matthew 11, 12, Jesus lays out for us the impact the kingdom of heaven makes in this world. It says, and from these are the words of Jesus, and from the time of John the Baptist began preaching until now, the kingdom of heaven has been forcefully advancing, and violent people are attacking it. When Jesus made this kind of unusual comment, he was saying that the kingdom of God, the way that God actually reigns in our world now, is powerful. But God's power is never through the means of coercion, manipulation, or violence. God's reign is all about goodness, liberty, reverence, and respect. Let me say that again. That's worth writing down. God's reign here on earth is all about goodness and liberty and reverence and respect. Our own personal reaction to extremism should not be to be stressed out, but to live into the calling of our own personal discipleship. One last scripture. 1 Peter, the third chapter. That's in the back of the book, by the way. You get to Revelation and go back toward the front. 1 Peter 3:9 says this, and this needs to be our mantra, actually, for our lives. Don't repay evil for evil. Don't retaliate with insults when people insult you. Instead, pay them back with a blessing. That is what God has called you to do, and He will grant you His blessing. Whew, powerful stuff. Friends, the peace that we seek this week during the season of Advent is the type of true peace that can only come from God. To overcome the stress created by excessive extremism requires me to do this. It requires me to focus on God's peace, to put all my trust in God in all situations, and to be a blessing to others. If we can do that this week, we have accomplished great things for the kingdom of heaven. And that, my friends, is the perfect type of action. Maybe that's the most perfect type of extremism that the world needs now. Let us pray. God, as we come here, I first confessed before you, Lord, that there are times that I let my own agenda overshadow yours. That it is easy sometimes to get caught up into extremism, into doing things that draw me away from you, and I confess that right now. Lord, we seek your Holy Spirit upon our lives. We seek that ability to find that peace that passes human understanding. Help us to focus on that. Help us to trust you, Lord, in every situation, in every conversation that we have. And Lord, open our eyes, especially during this time of year, that we might be a blessing to others. Lord, we pray that in your name. Amen. Friends, I found out this week that the word Noel means birth. When we become fully committed followers of Jesus, we experience a new birth where we can be an example to others, to be the example of goodness and liberty and reverence and respect. So now, as we prepare ourselves, let us sing of the birth of the one who changes our lives to be more Christ-like. What a beautiful reminder that the light of the world was given for you and me, for us. Our peace is found in the gift that we celebrate at Christmas. Friends, I've got a couple discipleship questions for you to wrestle with today in your small group, in your worship circle, maybe over the breakfast table with whoever's sitting across from you, maybe calling up a friend or scheduling a time on Facebook to have a chat. Some great questions to help you grow deeper in your connection to God so that you might be that person filled with the peace of God as an example to others. So the first question, in our desire to live into God's reign of love, in what settings do my actions reflect God's goodness and liberty and reverence and respect? Second thing to consider is share a time when God's unexplainable peace has helped you through a difficult time in your life. Great questions for you this week to discuss and grow deeper in your faith. And just want to remind you that when I get finished praying, we're not finished worshiping. Got a great family ministry video. And if you enjoyed Pastor Amy's sermon last week about Mary, you get to see it again in a kids version. So stay tuned for that. Gather the kids, gather the big kids. I enjoy watching it myself. So join me as we finish. Let us be a church in prayer. God, I give you thanks for this awesome, wonderful, powerful scripture that you provide for us to help us grow deeper and stronger and more committed. Lord, help us to set aside any kind of action or participation that we might have in extremism, and help us to move past being stressed and immerse ourselves in your peace. Lord, we pray that in Jesus' name. Amen.
The Bible, it's 66 books of history, stories, letters, and poetry that fit together to form God's one big story. The epic adventure of how he created us and loves us so much that he made a way to rescue us. As we travel through the Bible, from Genesis to Revelation, we discover people who met God and found their lives changed forever. Now, for an amazing story, inspired by the book of Luke, chapter 1, verses 26 through 56.
Mary lived in the tiny town of Nazareth, an ordinary village at the edge of Jewish lands.
Nazareth? Can anything good come from there?
Mary herself was an ordinary girl.
Oh, hello.
She grew up learning the Jewish scriptures.
A child will be born to us, a son will be given to us, he will rule over us, and he will be called Wonderful Advisor and Mighty God. When will this happen?
Only God knows. It's been hundreds of years.
Mary went to fetch water from the well and baked loaves of bread and swept out the hard-packed earth floor.
It's important to clean the dirt off the dirt.
She was also engaged to be married to a carpenter named Joseph. Mary must have expected that her life would follow a very ordinary path until one day when everything changed.
Greetings, Mary.
Suddenly, right there in the dim room, a brilliant being appeared. Mary probably dropped whatever she was holding, a broom, a batch of bread dough, a needle and thread.
Who? Me?
The Lord has blessed you in a special way. He is with you.
Mary blinked, trying to take it all in. The whole room glowed with light.
I don't understand.
Do not be afraid, Mary. God is very pleased with you.
Mary couldn't find any words. In one heartbeat, her very ordinary day had flipped upside down.
You will become pregnant and give birth to a son. You must call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High God. He will rule forever over his people. That kingdom will never end.
The words of Isaiah may have echoed in Mary's head.
A child will be born to us. A son will be given to us. He will rule over us.
She finally found her voice.
How can this happen? I'm not even married yet.
The light flared even brighter.
The Holy Spirit will make this happen. Your relative Elizabeth will have a child even though she is old. People thought she could not have children, but she has been pregnant for 6 months now. That's because what God says will always come true.
Mary's heart pounded. Her cousin Elizabeth was old enough to be a grandmother, and if she was having a baby, anything could happen.
I serve the Lord. May it happen to me just as you said it would.
The light faded. The towering angel disappeared.
Mary leaned against the wall to collect her thoughts.
Elizabeth, I have to go see her.
The journey to Elizabeth and Zechariah's home in the hill country of Judah would have taken many days of travel along dusty roads. Finally, Mary arrived.
Why, it's Mary.
Elizabeth, I have so much to tell you.
As Mary spoke, Elizabeth could feel the child inside of her leap and kick for joy. God's Holy Spirit spoke to Elizabeth.
God has blessed you more than other women, and blessed is the child you will have. As soon as I heard the sound of your voice, the baby inside of me jumped for joy. You are a woman God has blessed. You have believed that the Lord would keep his promises to you.
Mary laughed and cried at the same time as she hugged her older cousin. God confirmed once again that Mary could find joy in the extraordinary plan God had for her.
Now tell me your story.
Mary stayed with Elizabeth for several weeks. She was so filled with joy, she poured out her heart in a song to God.
My soul gives glory to the Lord. My spirit delights in God, my Savior. He has taken note of me, even though I'm not considered important. He shows his mercy to those who have respect for him. He has filled with good things those who are hungry. He has helped the people of Israel who serve him. He has done it just as he had promised to our people of long ago.
At the end of 3 months, Mary returned home to Nazareth, ready to see how God's plan was about to unfold.